Please be seated. Good morning, family of cooks. Welcome to the service. A very special word of welcome to those joining us by YouTube and by Zoom. The Langley Presbyterian Church family and friends in Alberta and Ontario. So we are so blessed that we can worship together. And this is not as warm as, like, say, 2 weeks back or a week back. So I'm going to keep my jacket on for as long as I can, and if it goes, you will know why. If the sermon gets heated, then the jacket has to go. No, no heated sermon. I just want to thank Alan for being here. Alan is not well, but he's so committed to the work of the Lord that he is here. So pray for Alan throughout the service that he will be fine, and what a servant of God he is. So thank you for being here. Friends, we still want to be careful. The pandemic is not over. We know that we've been told that all restrictions have been lifted, but we agreed last week that if you still want to wear a mask, you can do that. We still don't want to congregate in the narthex after the service. We still don't want to do the passing of the peace, like going to one another and shaking hands, things like that. And we're going to take baby steps. The choir will sing a piece, Amigos de Cristo, and we're all going to stand here on the steps. I just thought that to have the choir sitting for half of the service very close to one another, that's not good. So we just want to be careful. We won't have coffee hour until basically beginning of August, and I know that at that time our attendance will double because Presbyterians love to eat and drink. We will have perhaps more people, but let's just come before God in a moment of silent preparation as we prepare our hearts for worship. God is in our midst, and let us meditate on that just for a moment before we begin our service. Amen. The call to worship. Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord, their God. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the ways of the wicked. Grace and peace be yours in abundance and the knowledge of God. Our opening hymn is for the beauty of the earth. What a wonderful blessing that God made us as a part of his creation, and that we can see the beauty of his creation. You know, I looked at our garden and I saw some leaves burned by the extreme heat, but then there were still the flowers really fighting against the heat as well. So it's such a wonderful blessing that we can sing for the beauty of the earth. Would you all please stand, and we sing number 98, stanzas 1, 3, and 5. Let us bow before God. Father, we praise you for a new day. We praise you for each day. We praise you for the beauty of the earth. And we place ourselves in your creation as we go for a hike, as we go on an ocean or a river, as we sometimes are just taken away with what your creation would tell us about you. Most often when we lift our eyes to the hills, we think of Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where will my help come from? My help is from the living God, the creator of heaven and earth. We praise you, Father, that you are our God, that you are in control, that you reign forever and ever, that before this world came into place, you already were God, you are God, and you will be God forever. And we worship you as the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for your presence in our lives through your Spirit. And that we all can rejoice in the beautiful words, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. We are so blessed as your people in this family, but then in each family of believers, it is only your presence, it's only your compassion, only your guidance, day by day, that would make it worth for us to be a part of your church. There are so many voices in this world, so many secular thoughts, but no matter what we hear, we know that you are in control and that you guide your people. And as our theme for this morning is, we know that we have peace to say, we know that you are above everything that we can think about. Thank you for our families. Thank you for each person associated with this family of believers. And the same with the Langley family and those in other places. Thank you that you loved us so much, that you gave us Jesus, and that you still love us far above our human comprehension. And therefore, because you love us, and we know that you will restore us and cleanse us, we all come in a moment of personal silence to confess our sins. Heavenly Father, it is in the wonderful and precious name of Jesus Christ that we come to you, the one name given in heaven and on earth by which people are saved, the name of Jesus, and that we have confessed. And it's in the name of Jesus that we hear the words, "Your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more." We praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Give us a new vision each day, and always remind us that you go before us. Amen. Our response is number 173, stanzas 1 and 5, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain?" Of God because of Jesus, that we have this assurance, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, and that we can be at peace with one another, and that I can say to you, the peace of Jesus Christ be with you all. Just turn around and just wave and just give that assurance. It's the very same as if we had shaken hands. That will come. We will be patient and wait for that. Please be seated. We have two scripture readings. Alec Hart is going to read Romans 8, verses 22 to 30, and I will be reading from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 7 to 13. So Romans 8, 22 through 30, and Ephesians chapter 3, verses 7 to 13.
I'll be reading the New English Version. To the present, you know, the whole splendor of children of the whole created universe groans in all its heart as in the pangs of childhood. Not only so, but even we, to whom all its parts in the pang, even we to whom the Spirit has given us the first fruits of the harvest to come, are groaning inwardly while we wait for God to make us his sons. And hope. Now to see no longer is to hope. For we have been saved though only in hope. Now to see is no longer to hope. Why should a man endure and wait for what he already sees? But if we hope for something we do not yet see, then in waiting for it, we show our endurance. In the same way the Spirit comes to us in the aid of our weakness. We do not even know how we are taught to pray, but through our inarticulate groans, the Spirit Himself is pleading for us. And God, who searches our inmost being, knows what the Spirit means, because He pleads for God's people in God's own way. And everything we know, He cooperates for good with those who love God, and we are called according to His purpose. For God knew His own before they were, and also ordained them that He should be shaped to the likeness of His Son, so that He might be the eldest among the large family of brothers. And it is these, so foreordained, who He has called, and those whom He has called, He has justified, and to those whom He has justified, He has also given His splendor. Amen.
Ephesians chapter 3, verses 7 to 13. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of His power. Although I am less than the least of all God's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make plain to everyone the administration of His mystery, which for ages past has kept hidden in God who created all things. His intent was that now, through the Church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to His eternal purpose, which He accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In Him and through faith in Him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory. This is the word of God to all of God's people. All praise we bring to God in every dominion of His reign. And now the choir will sing Amigos de Cristo.
Bye.
how some of you moved with the music. I remember one of my colleagues back in South Africa said, "I have a reform heart, but I have evangelical feet." I remember that so well. So that is so precious that we could have sung this and that you people heard it. And we are friends of the Lord because He first became our friend, Jesus, our Lord. Let's bow our heads and reflect on these passages and ask God that He Himself will speak to us. Amen. Three little boys were in the backyard playing, and pretty soon they got into this old thing, you know. I think you are familiar with this, you know. It's like one kid would say, "My daddy is bigger than your daddy," and then another kid would respond by saying, "My dad is better than your dad," and unfortunately, quite often it would end with, "My dad can beat up your dad." Not what we want to hear. So these three boys were in the backyard, and one said, "My dad knows the mayor." And the second boy thought that he wanted to top that, and he said, "Oh, that's nothing. My dad knows the governor." And then the first boy turned to the third boy and said, "If your dad doesn't know the president, there's no way you're going to win this one." But as it happened to be, the third boy's father was in the kitchen because they were playing in his backyard, and he overheard the whole thing that has been said so far, and he was wondering how his child was going to respond. But his son was very calm when he said, "You know, it's so much better with my dad than with your dad's. My dad knows God, and higher than that, you can never go." There was nothing they could come back with. And the father in the kitchen had tears coming to his eyes as he thought by himself, "Nothing better can ever be said about me." The question this morning is, how many people can affirm the words from Romans 8 verse 28? And we know that in all things, God. Because there are many people in this world who have heard about God, they don't necessarily question the existence of God, but with them it's very much the same as what we read in James chapter 2 verse 19. You say there is one God, good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You see, there are people who do not know God in a personal relationship. They do not know God for what God can do in their lives and how God will bring everything to fulfillment, how everything will be steered right to the end of the world, and how things would fall in place only as God can make them to fall into place. But I want us to pause for a moment and think of what we can say of what we know in this world. What can we say with certainty from a worldly perspective? We know. We don't know when COVID-19 will be completely over. And unfortunately, we don't know what other type of thing might come, like the pandemic. Is there something else coming? We don't know that. We don't know anything about employment to be in place for the years to come. We don't know anything about human resources to be in place, because more and more we hear about countries where just the basic necessities are not met. We don't know anything about world peace in our future. What if North Korea would launch some of their missiles on innocent countries? Do you agree with me? There's not only anything in this world, really, anything that we can say about we know. I know. But then, friends, we can place God in everything. But I need to rephrase. We cannot place God in anything. God is already in everything. It's not for us to call God to be in something, as we sing in our closing refrain so often, God will be there. That is the wonderful peace we can have in our hearts, that God knows everything about the past, everything about the present, everything about the future, and that in Him everything holds together. That is the peace that we have. That is what we can say today. We know. We know that God is in control. And there is such a wonderful word that He gave through the prophet Jeremiah, a word for the people of that time, a word for all generations, a word for our present generation, a word that will stand till the end of time. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. And that is what would bring such peace to our hearts. St. Paul wrote to Roman Christians who felt very much oppressed. They felt that they suffocated under the grip of the Roman authorities. And they experienced firsthand what happened to people in their community. They were those who were dispossessed from what they earned over years, as it ended up in the coffers of Caesar. And then they witnessed how severely some people were punished because they did not worship the idols that had been placed in all different places in the city of Rome. They felt oppressed. And it wasn't for no reason that verse 23 was included in the writing of Paul, but we ourselves who have the firstborn of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we wait with eager anticipation for our adoption as sonship, the redemption of our bodies. Friends, think about this for a moment. When you and I groan inwardly, it might be because of some kind of disease. Sometimes we're in pain. Sometimes we groan because we're in pain. Sometimes we might have a life situation that is so difficult for us, and that we feel that the weight is just too heavy. Then we groan. But those Roman Christians, they groaned because of their stand for Jesus Christ. That is why they groaned. And they had questions. And St. Paul wrote to them and he gave them words of encouragement in this 8th chapter of his letter. And many people say that this perhaps can be seen as one of the greatest chapters ever written in a book. And he encouraged them. And it's like Paul stands here today and Paul wants to give us this information. He wants to give us encouragement as well. And from verse 28 that we want to focus on, the first thing that we should know is that God is at work. Now, when we look at this verse, we see that the placement of God's name varies from one translation to the other. In the King James, we read that all things work together for the good for them that love God. And then in the New American Standard Translation, it says that God secures all things to work for the good And then we already know what the NIV says, and we know that in all things God works for the good. But the point is, it doesn't matter where God's name is placed in a sentence, in a verse, or wherever people would place God's name, God is always at work. And even when people would want to take God out of the picture, as we see in our world, that people just want to scratch the name of God from government institutions and from the manifests of different organizations, God will always be at work far more than what any human mind can comprehend. And I want you to think with me for a moment. The insignificance of the stable of Bethlehem, because the inn was shut to the Savior of the world, became one of the most prominent landmarks of all time. Because there, the world had to learn that God's ways are different from our ways, and that God's thoughts are always above our thoughts. People didn't really think that there would be anything good in that stable, but the only good came from that stable. The Savior of the world was born in that stable. But why did St. Paul want those Christians in Rome and Christians of all generations to know that God is at work? Because he wanted to tell them that in the midst of hardship and persecution, God is there and God is at work. I think that you are familiar with the name Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He was the German pastor who went against the Nazis, and he was imprisoned at Flossenbürg, and it was during an Advent season that he preached to the prisoners, and that he said, "The celebration of Advent is only possible for those who are troubled in their spirit, for those who know that they are poor and imperfect, for those who are longing for something greater to come." And I think with what we can learn from St. Paul, not just this one verse, verse 28, but the whole passage, the whole letter to the Romans, and what we can learn from other apostles as well, is the fact that God is at work for something better. God is at work for something greater. And earlier in chapter 8, St. Paul rejoiced in the fact that our future glory would outweigh the sufferings that we presently go through. And I don't think that we can compare our sufferings with those of the ancient Christians. But if we feel oppressed, if we feel that there is no room for us as Christians, if we feel that Christian principles are just swept aside, there is the Word of God that comes to us that we can say, we know God is at work, and God will make us more than conquerors in His Son, Jesus Christ. There is a second reality from verse 28 that St. Paul wants to bring to us, that we can say, we know that God works in all things. Why would St. Paul have said that to the Romans? Why would St. Paul bring it to us on this day, right here, as if he is standing right here? Because God works in good times and in bad times. God works through good things and bad things. And that's something that we just do not really want to comprehend. That's something that we don't really want to hear. Because people say that when I experience the good things, then I know that God is with me. It reminds me so much of Genesis chapter 26, where we read that Isaac was blessed immensely by the Lord, and that he became a very rich man, that he had a very big herd of livestock, and that his territory expanded and expanded. And it got to a point that Abimelech, who was a foe, really, of Isaac, came to him and said, "We have seen that the Lord was with you." Genesis 26, verse 28. And that was a human response of how it went with Isaac. And you see, we from our human perspective would want to say, if you are healthy and you have a good bank account and you have all kinds of prosperity, that equals the blessings and the presence of the Lord. But can you appreciate with me that God can work through the hardships of people? And that's something that Catherine Marshall, the wife of Reverend Peter Marshall, experienced firsthand. She was struck with tuberculosis, and she was bound to a wheelchair. And God was busy to shape her into something better for His service. And she became a motivational speaker. And she told people on numerous occasions, "God prepared me for this service." We are human beings, and quite often we just don't want hardships as a part of our lives. We want to have smooth sailing. We don't want to end up in the storms of life. And then we want to cry out like so many servants of God, "Lord, why this? Lord, where are you? Why are you doing this?" Yesterday we watched a film called Another Mother's Son, and it's about this British woman who took in a Russian soldier, and she looked after him, hid him in her place. He became like a son to her, but when she mentioned God, he got so upset and he said, but where is God? There was a 16-year-old in my battalion who prayed, and it didn't work out for him. He died. Where was God? And it took him time to really come around. It's just a human part of us that sometimes we can't comprehend these things. But then we come to that understanding that God is working in all things, and that when we go through the hardships in life, then we know that He is like the potter, shaping the clay in a better form than what we can ever want it to be. So if that is what God is presently doing in your life, do not rebel, but know in all things God is present, and God works. And then Paul says that God works for the good. That's the third point of our sermon. But the question is it really true that God always works for the good? I recall in my ministry back in South Africa, there was a couple whose son-in-law died of malaria, and I read this very same verse. And I spoke and I said, "God loves you and God works for the good." And the man immediately interrupted me, very angry. And he said, "Just don't bring that to me. That is just not true. There's nothing good in what God did to take my son-in-law. Why would you even tell me that?" And that's before I could come and tell him that through the difficulty, in the end, things will work out the way they should and would. people would ask, what is the good in it that God would allow some children to be orphans on the streets in most African countries? What is the good that God would allow children to be in a cancer hospital? But it's like Paul wanted to just stop everybody with those questions, and Paul just wanted to say, you need to appreciate that we are going towards the good when all these things would be something of the past, when that time will come when we all will be more than conquerors in Jesus Christ. And you know, that is what we have to focus on. We just have to know that in this life, the good cannot last. It would not prevail. It's going to fade away. There's too many hurts, too many hardships. But God just wants to bring us to that point to say, think of how it is going to be established in your life. Irving Stone, an author, made a study of the life of people who really reached great accomplishment in life, people like Michelangelo, Van Gogh, and Beethoven. And then he said, though they were knocked down by circumstances in life, they all rose up to great accomplishment. And that's the message. Though you might feel that quite often you are knocked down by life because of some things, focus on the good. Focus on the eternal. Focus on what is beyond and above the ruins of this world. Because, friends, there are too many people who are presently testing everything about God with what they see presently. When they see the famines and they see the destruction and they see the earthquakes and the floods. And hungry children crying. We know that God will take us beyond these things. And He will still bring us to that point to say, you will be better. I will be the one to make you better. Until you are ready to be in the good, in the perfect. Friends, life is a wonderful gift, but life for many people are very hard presently. If we really think of the world we live in, we too want to groan inwardly. Not just because of a disease that we might have, as I mentioned, but there might be a hardship. And then God would say to us, know that I am in control, and I will take you through this all, and I will bring you to the heavenly harbor. It's been a difficult time for many of us. I think where things happened far away from us, there are now some of us in this place of worship, and some of us joining us by YouTube who lost family members because of COVID, and there are some who lost people because of the heat wave that we had. And God just wants us to be taken above these things. You will be more than conquerors. And I want you to repeat in your own mind what I'm now saying. I know God is in control. If you can just say that to yourself, I know God is in control. May God guide us, may He bless us, may He give us the peace that is above all understanding. Amen. Father, what a wonderful blessing for us to say, we know In all things, we know that you work, for the good, and that hardship and persecution, famine, nakedness, and sword, and demons, and anything else, and all of your creation cannot separate us from your love, because it was and is secured in Jesus Christ. We pray for courage. We pray that we always will see you, Lord Jesus, as our vision, and that we will not live one moment to take our eyes off you. We fix our eyes on you, the author and perfecter of our faith, and we know that you will take us safely home. Thank you for this wonderful blessing that we could worship, that we would not stop to be here, that no one told us it's not allowed to worship. Just hold this very close to your heart. But equip us, Father, because now we have to go out and we have to tell others in doubt, I know, we know, that all things will work for the good. Thank you for this family of believers. Thank you that you kept us safe through the pandemic. Thank you that gradually we can get back into all of our activities, our ministries. We pray that you will continue to bless us all and guide us as only you can do. Bring an understanding in our hearts that through difficulty you will bring the best in us. Thank you that we can pray for our leadership, elders, the board of managers, for what they do, for the leadership. Thank you that you have equipped each one, and that you will do that, continue to do that. Thank you that we can pray for those on our prayer list when we bring before you Joe, Herb, Barb, Jack, Betty, Cameron, Rosalie, Lintetz, Earl, Heidi, Dennis, Beverly, Marie, Les, Tim, Aline, Christopher, Christina, Bridget, and the people from the Langley family, Eleanor Haddo, Betty Severance, Eleanor Mills and her husband on the passing of her daughter, and Heather and children. Give a peace that only you can give. Give an assurance that only you can give. Bring the words of St. Paul from Philippians 4, verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, through prayer and petition, make known your requests to God. And then the wonderful verse 7. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Lord Jesus, thank you for the model prayer, and that we all can pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and power, and the glory, forever. Amen. We still will just receive an offering in the plates. It will take a little time before we would distribute the plates. So thank you for all who will today make a contribution, those who will do it in this coming week, those who will do it by he transfer. Let us all stand and sing the doxology. God, giver of all good gifts, in gratitude we bring our gifts today. Use them to the end that your kingdom might come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Just a few announcements. We will resume on August 25th with our Zoom Bible studies. Please come and join us Wednesday at 10 for Zoom Coffee Hour. Please be in touch with Alan Turberfield for details. Happy birthday today to Jewel Hester and Brian Buckley, tomorrow, July 12th. Happy anniversaries to Lynn and Colin Taylor, that's on the 15th, and Helen and Jack Parry on the 16th of July. May God bless you and keep you and give you wonderful grace. Those a few announcements. Our closing hymn is How Firm a Foundation. It's number 425. If you please stand for stanzas 1, 4, and 5. Number 425, stanzas 1, 4, and 5. As the people of God, to go out and say, we know, I know, in Jesus Christ, everything is secure. We know, I know, as we speak with people to say, God wants to give you that assurance in your life as well. So let's be God's agents and let's speak the word of truth, the word of hope in Jesus Christ. Receive the benediction of our Lord and go in His peace. The grace of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the love of God our Father, and the companionship of God the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.